Joining us now for Hot Copy, we have House Deputy Speaker Surigao del Sur Representative Johnny Pimentel. He's one of the lawmakers who filed a bill to grant ABS-CBN a fresh franchise. Good morning to you, Congressman Pimentel.
Well, good morning, Karen. Good morning to your televiewers.
All right. Congressman, what do you believe was achieved yesterday, considering some have said the NTC and the Solicitor General faced lawmakers, but first, the NTC did not, Congress did not cite NTC in contempt like what Congress said it would do?
Well, first of all, Karen, what was important yesterday was that the authors of the different bills were able already to sponsor the respective bills.
Mm-mm.
Because if you will recall, we already had two hearings, but unfortunately, the authors were not able to sponsor the bills. And that is not following the right procedure. Whenever there is a hearing, the first order of business is for the authors to sponsor the bill. But in this case, we were given a chance on the third hearing. Now, yesterday, as you have already seen, the NTC was able to air their side in the OSG. They were not cited for contempt because they were able to attend the hearing. And I believe that in the succeeding hearings, they will still be required to attend the hearings.
Required to attend the hearings, but the NTC and the Office of the Solicitor General already invoked the sub judice rule, meaning they refused to answer questions that issues that they filed in the Supreme Court. So it seems to be a dead end in this situation. What does Congress expect to do?
That is what I find surprising, because we're implementing a double standard. While the OSG and NTC has invoked the sub judice rule, however, the ABS-CBN is required to answer the questions that are being raised against them. I think in this case, if the sub judice rule does not apply to ABS-CBN, it should not also apply to NTC and OSG. And more than that, under the Constitution, Karen, the Congress is allowed to conduct inquiries in aid of legislation in accordance with its published rules of governing procedure. I don't believe that in this case, this is only my opinion, the sub judice rule will apply, because under our house rules, even if there is a case pending on a subject matter that is being investigated, it does not prohibit the committee to conduct an inquiry. So for me, I think it will not jeopardize their case if they will be allowed to answer the questions in the committee. So, but it is up to the committee if they will allow the both are government agencies to invoke the sub judice rule. It's now it now depends on the committee.
Now, Congressman Pimentel, what would be the end game in terms of issues, frankly, that some feel need to be answered by the Supreme Court, being the interpreter of the Constitution? I'll give you one example. Gabby Lopez being a Filipino, ABS-CBN has stated the facts, and yet congressmen against the reopening of ABS-CBN still believe that he is not a Filipino. Clearly, the final arbiter would be the Supreme Court. But ABS-CBN is seeking a franchise renewal or even a new franchise to operate. What happens with issues like that? Will Congress decide on that matter?
Well, at the end of the day, Congress will have to decide whether to deny or to grant a franchise to ABS-CBN. And that is precisely what we are doing right now. And what is good, actually, is that the hearings are now moving.
Mm-mm.
Whereas compared to other several months, there were no hearings that were conducted. Now, this is now the time for both sides to present their arguments. And this is now the time also or opportunity for ABS-CBN to answer those allegations. Now, as per our ground rules, there are many issues to be deliberated on. And the committee has decided that one of the rules is that we will hear issues per hearing basis, meaning one issue will be heard on one hearing. For example, the citizenship issue, it will be set aside for one hearing. If it will not be finished in one hearing, then another hearing will be set aside for that issue. After that has been completed, then another issue will be tackled, the constitutionality of the takeover of ABS-CBN in 1986. That will be tackled in another hearing again. Then the issuance of PDRs, it will be tackled in another hearing again para hindi magulo, so that there will be a sense of orderliness that only one subject will be tackled in one hearing. Now, after all the arguments have been heard for and against and whatever discussions that will be made, then a voting will be made. Now, as per our ground rules, only members of the Legislative Franchise Committee can vote, but also ex-officio members can vote. So there are 46 members of the Legislative Franchise who will vote. Now, aside from that, there are 22 deputy speakers that is allowed to vote. There are 14 deputy majority leaders that are allowed to vote. Then there are 7 minority leaders that are allowed to vote, and the senior deputy majority leader, senior deputy minority leader, the majority leader, and even the speaker himself can also vote. So there will be a total of 93 voting members of Congress who will vote after the deliberations have been completed. Now, for ABS-CBN to be granted a franchise, they will need at least 48 votes from these voting members.
And that's all you need, the 48 votes from the voting members for ABS-CBN to operate again. Just 48 votes.
Yes. If I'm not mistaken, if my count is correct, but I already counted the voting members, 93. Well, the 50% of that is 46.5. So it should be 50% plus one. So I surmise it should be 48 votes for ABS-CBN to again operate.
Yes. So unlike voting for other bills, you don't need the majority of Congress.
This is only for the committee level.
Yes, yes.
Because our procedure is that we are deliberating on a bill, or we are still on the committee level.
Yes.
So after the voting has been done in the committee level, then of course we will also vote on the committee report, and this will be
that's what I wanted to
calendar for business for second reading on the plenary session. Then in the plenary session, there will be again, it will be open again for interpellations. It will be open for amendment. Now, during the interpellations, again, there will be some congressmen who will be allowed to speak for and against of for ABS-CBN. In short, after the committee level has been approved, then the whole Congress will vote it assuming that it has been approved on second reading, then we will vote on it for nominal voting on third reading, and all 304 members of Congress will vote on it.
Exactly. Okay, that's what I wanted to get to. Given this scenario of, you said, one issue per day of hearing, Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano said that he was optimistic that come August, a decision would be made. Are you seeing that timeline as possible at this point?
Yes, it is highly possible, especially if we will continue the hearings. For this week, we have another hearing for tomorrow. So we are conducting 2 hearings per week. Now, if we will be able to conduct 2 hearings per week, I believe that we can satisfy all the interpellators because I've already seen the list of interpellators for each issue, and there are at least 10 congressmen who would like to interpellate on each issue, and the list is growing. Now, there are several issues. You have the taking over of ABS-CBN in 1986, the citizenship issue, the tax issue, the labor issue, and other several issues that needs to be answered. But if we can have a hearing in 2 weeks per, 2 days, 2 days, two hearings per week, then I suppose in 2 months' time, I'm very confident that we'll be able to finish and we'll go to a voting.
Okay. Now, what's interesting is Gabby Lopez was subpoenaed for the next hearing. That's correct, Deputy Speaker.
Yes, and I strongly suggest if Mr. Gabby Lopez is listening, he should. It is imperative that he should attend the meeting or the hearing, whether on Zoom or whether he physically attends the session, because if he does not attend to the hearing, then a show cause order will be issued to him why he should not be cited for contempt. And in that case, if you will be cited for contempt, then a warrant of arrest will be issued against him for him to attend the hearing, just like what we did to Ronnie Dayan. So I'm actually appealing to Gabby Lopez to attend the hearing, because if not, then there will be a big problem.
And is it fair to say that what will be tackled during the next hearing is only the citizenship issue with Mr. Lopez? That's essentially it?
Well, as per our ground rules, supposedly one issue, one hearing. But the constitutionality of the takeover was also raised. But I believe if Mr. Gabby Lopez will attend, then the issue of citizenship will prevail and will be prioritized.
Okay. Now, Deputy Speaker, most of the issues, as the ABS-CBN President and CEO, Carlo Katigbak, when he defended what he claims are truth, he cited several agencies that essentially support his argument, so to speak, like the accusation that the Lopez family got ABS-CBN quickly. Katigbak essentially narrated it in detail that no less than the Office of the President, no less than the Supreme Court, no less than the PCGG were all involved. Legitimate agencies of government, the President and the Supreme Court. So the question is essentially, those who don't agree with that particular statement will stick to it, and yet the facts are there. I've always said people are entitled to their own opinion, but not their own set of facts.
Yes, I believe that Mr. Carlo Katigbak has rightfully and satisfactorily answered the allegations or the questions, especially with regards to the takeover of ABS-CBN. Because if you recall, in 1972, when martial law was declared, the Marcos government took over ABS-CBN without any just compensation. So after 1986, it was given back by the Cory administration to ABS-CBN. It was theirs. The ABS-CBN was owned by the Lopez family even during the martial law years. Now, there are rumors, there are stories that there was a deed of sale that was signed by the Lopez family and President Marcos. But where is that evidence? There is no evidence showing that ABS-CBN was sold to the Marcos government. In fact, if you will really analyze everything, the government owes ABS-CBN. Why? Because they used the facilities, the equipment of ABS-CBN for several years. And when they took over, ABS-CBN was not even paid by the government. So it was there from the very beginning. They just took back what is theirs.
Now, is it fair to say, in layman's terms, because I saw the issue matrix that is to be discussed in Congress. Is it fair to say that the committee report will essentially declare which argument is what Congress will believe or deem to be true? I think that's what's important here, because then it ends up a congressman to be a he said, she said, this person doesn't agree, ABS insists this. Will Congress, can we expect the committee report, therefore, to make that stand at the end of the day? For example, will it declare Gabby Lopez is a Filipino citizen? Will it declare in the committee report that ABS-CBN was able to recover its assets legally? Will it declare that?
The committee report will contain everything. Mm-mm. Because okay. I was a chairman of one committee of good government before. Mm-mm. And I've seen so many committee reports. Sometimes it has several pages which will contain everything that we have discussed during the hearings. Now, if the committee will rule in favor of ABS-CBN, then it will justify or it will confirm the answers of ABS-CBN. It will justify why ABS-CBN should be granted a franchise. Then it will justify that ABS-CBN did not commit any violation of law of the Philippines so that it should be granted. In the other side, if the committee will decide against ABS-CBN, then we will have to justify all the issues that rightly Gabby Lopez is not a citizen, then the PDRs is a violation of the Constitution of foreign ownership. All of this, issues will be defended in the committee report, whether it will rule in favor or whether it will rule against.
Okay. I don't mean to belabor this point, but this is why I want to get into this discussion. It's because you just said if they vote against, then let's say if they decide that Gabby Lopez is not a Filipino citizen, my question is, does Congress have the power to decide that? Doesn't that rest with the Supreme Court, for example? Citizenship that issue.
That is the last recourse of ABS-CBN. But as far as the franchise of ABS-CBN is concerned, Congress has the sole authority to grant or deny the franchise.
Yes, clear. So what you're saying is Congress can make a decision on the citizenship.
Well, it will be a whole package. It will be the whole issues, not only the citizenship. Meaning, if the committee will rule against ABS-CBN, then we will have to defend our accusations. We will have to prove that indeed ABS-CBN violated certain laws of the Philippines. Ganun na mangyayari yun. Now, if we rule in favor, then we also have to accept the arguments of ABS-CBN that they were correct. In short, the committee report will justify their decision on whether it denied or we granted the franchise.
Okay. Another issue, Deputy Speaker, is the 50-year cap on franchises. No less than a framer of the Constitution, Christian Monsod, said that Congressman Marcoleta misinterpreted the Constitution when it comes to the 50-year cap. This is a framer. And Monsod even cited that he even picked the wrong article when it comes to ABS-CBN. The article he claims that Marcoleta picked had something to do with public utilities, and Monsod said ABS-CBN is not a public utility because it is not a monopoly. Only public utilities are regulated. Is Congress planning, for example, to invite framers of the 1987 Constitution to already clear the air on whatever interpretation some congressmen may have of the Constitution?
Well, at this moment,
is that part of that?
At this moment in time, there is no plan yet to invite Mr. Monsoon.
But or other framers, or other framers.
Framers. Maybe in the it depends on the committee on who the source persons will be invited. But let us talk about the 50-year term limit. I think Mr. Monsoon is correct because under the Constitution, it clearly states that Congress can grant a franchise with no more than 50 years as term limit. It is a single franchise. It does not mean cumulative, no? So each franchise, in fact, it just states there that the maximum limit given to a franchise applicant is 50 years. But the tradition of Congress is that we give only 25 years. But we can give a 10-year franchise, we can give a 40-year franchise. Now, let us explore the term limits. As I've said, it is not cumulative. Now, ABS-CBN operated on different, on multiple laws, okay? In 1950, the predecessor ABS-CBN, what is Bulinaw Electronics Corporation, the BEC, in 1950, the Public Act 511 was passed granting a temporary permit to BEC. Then BEC was renamed Alto Broadcasting System to be known as ABS. Then ABS was merged to Chronicle Broadcasting Network when the Lopez family bought Bulinaw Electronics Corporation. So it became to be known ABS-CBN. Now in 1969, Republic Act 5730 amended Republic Act 511, giving authority, giving a permit to ABS-CBN to operate. So in short, there were several laws that allowed ABS-CBN to operate. So under the several laws, there were several years that they were allowed to operate. Hindi naman na i-compute mo yan cumulatively. Na ibig sabihin na kung nabigyan ka ng franchise dati, i-add mo yung 20 years, i-add mo yung 25 years, then you will be violating the 50-year term limit. That 50-year term limit is for a single franchise, for a single law. But ABS-CBN, since 1950, has been allowed to operate under several laws. So where is the violation there? When in fact, after the 1995, President Ramos signed a law, Republic Act 7966, Allah giving franchise to ABS-CBN. Once franchise expired, ABS-CBN signed off. So where's the violation?
Okay, Congressman, it's clear, of course, I agree with you, but the bigger issue is, some may argue in Congress, that's your point of view, that's your argument. And of course, those against the reopening of ABS-CBN will insist that is not how you interpret the Constitution, which is why I am sticking to the question, how will Congress decide if it becomes a he said, she said in Congress? Because, for example, there is just one truth with the 50-year limit when the Constitution was written. There was one intention. It is not open to many interpretations. My only question, sir, is how will Congress resolve that when clearly those who are against the reopening of ABS-CBN will stay that way? So who's to say what is truth at the end of the day, Congressman?
Actually,
who's going to settle that?
This will become clearer as the hearings progresses.
Mm-mm.
Because at this moment, we only are at the tip of the iceberg.
Mm-mm.
We have not heard every argument. There are several issues to be resolved. There are several congressmen who would like to interpellate, who would like to ask questions. And if ABS-CBN can satisfactorily answer this, and if it can be shown that they did not violate any law, and it will be up to Congress to consolidate all these arguments and come up to a decision. At the end of the day, it will be the voting members who will decide whether to grant or deny the franchise of ABS-CBN.
On that note, is there anything you'd like to add, Deputy Speaker, before we go?
No, thank you very much for this opportunity to clarify some issues, Karen. Good morning.
And I appreciate it as always. Take care of yourself, sir.
Thank you.